All of a sudden, she flips the light on. I'm blinded by the light. And in the moment as my eyes are trying to adjust, I realize I've been set up. This guy's standing now in the room. He's only about a foot from me, but in his hand, he's holding a butcher knife, the blade 9.5 inches long. He looks me directly in the eyes and he says these words, "Now you're going to die." Before I have a chance to move, he swings that knife. It goes into my chest, 1/8 of an inch below my heart, comes out my back. The only thing that stopped it was the handle. I remember feeling this sharp pain. I looked down quickly and I saw the handle of the knife against my chest. And before I could process that, he pulls it out and starts to swing again. This time it's coming toward my eye, so I move back, but he lunges toward me and it goes into my throat. It goes in one side and it comes out the other. It cuts my jugular vein completely in half. I realize he's a madman. He's trying to kill me and he's not going to stop. I've got to fight my way out of this. I hit him as hard as I can. I knock him backwards. He falls down on the floor and I leap over him. But as I do, he stabs me the third time in the liver. Now I grab the door and he's starting to scramble to get back up. As he's getting up and I'm trying to get the door open, I realize I have locked the door from the inside. I do my best to get it up, but I don't have any time. I'm fighting for every second. And so it's at that moment I realize I've got to make a break for it. My life is now about to end. If I'm ever going to make it, I've got to do it now. I've got to make a break for it. Don't wait until you're at death's door to change the direction of your life. Make a break for it today.
That's a powerful story. Just a little snippet, really, a 2-minute clip of a testimony that you're going to get to hear in 2 weeks. Bill Purvis, pastor of Cascade Hills Church in Columbus, Georgia, is going to be here with us all morning. He's going to be in all 3 services. We're actually going to also simulcast him over to Harrison Bridge. And the day is Sit With Me Sunday, and I know you've been hearing that a lot the last few weeks, but man, we cannot overemphasize it. We are really pushing a lot of evangelistic emphasis on this one day, January 29th, where you have an opportunity to do more than pray. It definitely is good to pray for lost people, right? It's good to share with a friend and say, "Hey, man, I got a lost friend I want you to pray for." It's definitely good to pray for a lost friend, but it is better to even do something about it, you know? And you may have shared your faith with your friend. You may have invited your friend to church before. They've never come. This is an opportunity. This is a prime opportunity to get someone who is not a believer to come to church with you. January 29th, Sit With Me Sunday. Man, we have these out in the lobby. We're going to hand you about 4 or 5 on the way out. We're going to have host team members ready at the door to give these to you. And I want to challenge you to find 3 or 4 or 5 people this week to put them in the hands of and get them here January 29th because this is going to be an opportunity. Hearing the story of grace from Bill Purvis is going to be powerful. All of us have a story. I have a story. You have a story. If you're a follower of Jesus, it's a story of darkness to light, right? A story of death to life. But this story is unique. It's an extreme story of a man who was stabbed 3 times and left for dead, and he cried out to God to save him, and he did, physically and spiritually. He called him to preach. The day that he went to Cascade Hills, as pastor, he was. It was Easter Sunday, and they had 44 people in worship that Easter Sunday. And today, now over 30 years later, over 10,000 members. God is just, I think there are daily baptisms at Cascade Hills. They actually have an outside baptistry. And so on a daily basis, people are being baptized into the body of Christ at Cascade in Columbus. That's a fantastic ministry. You don't want to miss the story here that day, but you also don't want to allow your friend or family member to miss it. So I'm spending a lot of time and investing a lot of energy into making sure you know this is important. So I want to challenge you to be a part of this. This could be what changes that friend or family member's life. After hearing the gospel, sharing the gospel 3 times that morning, hopefully, I'm just going to go and tell you, I'm praying for 3,000 people to be here that day in all services, all campuses. I'm praying that over 100 people get saved. And if we see that kind of response to the gospel on that morning, then that evening is going to be an exciting time too, because after every service, we're going to encourage those who've made a decision to come back that evening for baptism. We're going to have a baptism service at 6:30 p.m. We're going to ask them to go home, share with their friends and their family member about what God did in their heart and their life that day, and to ask them to come back and see them be baptized that evening here. And so, man, it's a very unique evangelistic opportunity. And I would just challenge you again to say, now is the time. Now's the time. I'm going to share with those friends. I'm going to invite those friends. I'm going to at least care enough about their eternity to invite them to sit with me on Sunday, January 29th. And so I challenge you to do that. Get those on the way out. And don't forget, next week we'll have one final push. But, man, I cannot overemphasize that enough. I just pray that you'll embrace this whole idea of build and bring, and this really a new strategy of a culture of invitation. Let's bring people to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do we go and tell? Absolutely. We must go and tell. But we also go and ask people to come and come to the house of God to hear the gospel and pray they'll be saved. Let's do that this next 2 weeks. Haggai chapter 2. Haggai chapter 2. If you remember, Haggai is the book after Zephaniah and is the book before Zechariah. Haggai chapter 2. And just to kind of reiterate what Pat's already said about Josh and Lydia, man, we are so blessed. I can't tell you, my man has some dance moves, there's no doubt. If you've seen the video, if you hadn't seen the video, you have no idea what we're talking about. But Josh just made this little video about the first week that he was here. He and Lydia made it, and he was just kind of dancing around the campus and stuff. 6,200 people watched this video. That's crazy, man. What in the world? A lot of people, if you didn't see it, you're one of the few, all right? So it was he's just such an energetic, exciting, enthusiastic guy, and he and Lydia are a blessing. We believe with all of our heart, a godsend. We prayed that God would bring us the particular children's minister that he would have us to have as Miss Kathy so well served, and now she went up and started serving in the group life ministry. And as Ashley made transition, Connections pastor and recreation, we had this opportunity, and Brother Josh and Lydia are stepping in there, being encouragement to them. Don't just know of them, get to know them. And I would challenge you to be here this evening at 5:30. Your children are going to love them. And so you need to know and love the people your children are going to love. And so come and meet them today. Would you one more time just welcome them to the family? Praise the Lord for Josh and Lydia. Amen. All right, Haggai chapter 2. We've been in a series called The Time Is Now. And just basically saying, you know, whatever you know God is calling you to do, don't put it off. Why would you wait? Why would you continue to wait to do tomorrow what you know what God is telling you to do today? And so for the last 3 weeks, even on the snow day or the ice day, depending on what you experienced last Sunday, we carried on and we had part two in the series. The first week we talked about choosing the hard right over the easy wrong, just reminding us it's always easy to do the wrong thing. It's more difficult to make the right choices in our life. But then second week we talked about persevering through discouragement. And we know in the text, Haggai, the Samaritans came against. If you remember, the children of Israel were called by God to come, go back and build the temple, to rebuild the temple there in Jerusalem. And so as they went back, the Samaritans rose up and they brought opposition to the people of God. And as a result, 15 years, they shut it down, man. They just stopped working on the temple for 15 years simply because of opposition. So the discouragement came, and it caused them not to progress in the purpose of God. And so we have to understand, if we understand the time is now, and this is when God is leading me to do what he's called me to do, I'm not going to wait any longer, then we're going to have to learn to persevere through that discouragement. That was last Sunday. You can go check it out online if you missed it. But then today, we're going to talk about the blessings of obedience. All of these are really kind of woven together, and a lot of them are going to kind of run, and you're going to hear one brick laid on top of another. But when we talk about the blessings of obedience, here's the simple truth of the matter, that we have to understand that God has an intended purpose and plan for our life. If we get off of the path that is his plan, then we can rest assured that we're not fulfilling the purpose that he's made us for, and then at the same time, we're not going to experience the promises that we're expecting. You see, a lot of times I think believers get all messed up. They get things backwards. They start thinking, well, I can claim the promises of God and live however I want to. That really isn't the case. There's one promise, obviously. When we come to know Jesus Christ as our Savior, We repent of our sins. We turn from our sin and ourselves. We turn to Jesus. He saves us. And so we're transformed immediately and eternally. That's awesome. So that is one promise that we can say, sure, once we have received the promise, it's a done deal. Yes. But in the Christian life, as we're walking through, as we're living this life, we're doing everything He's called us to do, we're on the path of purpose, it's also a path of promise. And if we leave the path of purpose, then we also leave the path of promise. Doesn't mean we're lost. It just means we're not living in victory. It means we're not living really in the spiritual vitality, the level of victory that we could or should as a child of God. And so the bottom line of the message this morning is this: when your heart isn't right with God, whatever you do will be wrong. When your heart isn't right with God, whatever you do will be wrong. And here's how that relates. If I'm on, maybe I'm trying to do the right thing, but I'm doing the right thing in my own way, and I'm going my own path, my heart is not right. Well, it doesn't matter what good things I do. Those good things aren't going to be right. And I'm not going to be living in the victory that God has called me to. And so the children of Israel, even though they had begun to build the temple, they had started building the temple. When the Samaritans came against them, they quit. Why did they quit? Their heart wasn't in it. It wasn't in their heart. I mean, they were just doing it. They were just going through the motions. Maybe they were a church attendee, but they weren't really, you know, heart convicted and bought out all in for Jesus. They were kind of halfway. They were half-hearted. And in the same way, we got to admit, sometimes we're very guilty of just going through the motions, doing the deal, walking through life, trying to make sure we do the things that everybody expects a believer to do that makes you look like you're walking the path. But if we're right, if we're telling the truth about it, our heart's not in it. And if our heart's not in it, then nothing else we're doing matters. It doesn't matter how good you look. It doesn't matter how much you talk like a Christian, how much you walk like a Christian. If you're not giving your heart completely to God, then you've missed the first step in the process. So in Haggai chapter 2, look at verse 5 with me, and we'll begin reading there. Verse 5, here's what it says. This is what I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, and my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. So notice, God said, my spirit's with you. There's no reason for you to be afraid, no reason for you to stop again, no reason for you to turn away from my purpose, my plan, because I'm remaining with you. I am there. My presence is with you. Look at verse 6. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all the nations, and what is desired by all nations will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. And I think it's important to see, man, I've said this in all services this morning, so important. Listen, He's the one that's going to fill His house with glory. It's not going to be filled by something we do. Now, we do need to prepare our hearts, obviously, to worship God. But God is the one that can bring His glory. And so He said, I will fill the house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. This glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord Almighty. And in this place, I will grant peace, declares the Lord Almighty. So we see in this few verses here in Haggai chapter 2, kind of the next stage in this process of restoration, rebuilding of the temple. And there's multiple principles we can draw from this passage. First thing in verse 5, it's really clear. Those who follow God's plan will enjoy His presence. In other words, those people who are on the path of God are going to be in the presence of God. Those people who are chasing the purpose of God, right? Those people are going to be experiencing the presence of God, unlike some other people. And here's the reason why we can know that. Last week we talked about, you know, people who pray for more of God. And there's even a song, and I actually kind of like the tune. I like the song. There's a lot of songs that talk about that, praying for more of God. You know, we want more of you, God. We want more of you, God. And I understand what we mean when we say or sing that, but here's the truth that we have to grab. This is, like, again, I said this last week. We have been given all of God, all right? There's none of God that has been held back from us.
So it's important if we're saying that kind of thing, we understand the context that we're saying it. First of all, God has revealed himself completely. There is no need for another book to be written to reveal God. The reason that believers, the reason Christians don't believe the Book of Mormon, just to be real specific, don't believe the Book of Mormon is an inspired document, is because God revealed himself in his word, the Bible. When the Bible was finished, God was finished revealing himself in the word. And so the revelation of God, God has completely revealed himself in his word. But then check this out. He also completely revealed himself in the person of Jesus Christ. He not only inspired writers to write about him, he was born and he walked this earth. So Jesus lived a life out. He revealed himself to us. The Holy Spirit, when Jesus ascended to heaven, the Holy Spirit came down and now is our comforter, right? He's our helper, paraclete in the Greek. That comforter, he is our God. He lives in us. And here's the deal that's so cool about it. We understand we have all of God. We have all of, there's none of God we don't have. So as we pray that prayer, here's what we're praying. As we sing that song or think those thoughts, here's what we mean. God, we realize you've given us all of you. Help me get rid of me, right? Help me empty me of myself so that I can make room for you. Because if there is any lack of God in us, if there's any lack of the presence of God around us, it is not God's fault, it is our fault, right? It's our fault because we have filled ourselves, we filled our lives, we filled our schedules, we filled our agendas, we filled our dreams with so much of us that there's no room for God in our lives. And so if there's any prayer we need to pray is, God, help us get rid of us so that we can make more room for you. Those who follow God's plan will enjoy his presence. And you may sometimes even have that, man, how does so-and-so just... We're sitting in the same worship service, and they just seem to have a completely different experience. I mean, they just seem to really, really connect with God in a different way. And I just, in some sense, this should liberate you. It is not because God loves them more than he loves you. It may be that God has more of them than he has of you. It could be that they're surrendered more. Could be that they're more connected. It could be they're even going through a tougher time. And they're more aware of their need for him. But listen, the truth is, those who follow God's plan will enjoy his presence. That is a fact. When we're on the path of God, we will be in the presence of God. But then also, those who obey God operate in his power and with his resources. So it's not just one, it's one thing to say, okay, God's omnipresent, he's everywhere, but he's also very much present with us when we empty ourselves. But not only is the presence of God with us, but the power of God is with us. When we're on this path that we're walking on, then his power is going to be our power. And see, the people of God could not build the temple of God in their own power. They quit. They packed it up. They went back, right? They quit for 15 years. In their own power and with their own resources, they couldn't do it. So it had to be that God stirred them up. Remember, last week he stirred them up. And as he stirred up their spirits, they embraced his calling to this pathway of purpose. And in the midst of this pathway and purpose, they found the presence of God. God was there. And as they went into his presence, they experienced his power and they enjoyed his resources. Now here's the deal. You might say, we're talking about an Old Testament book, Haggai. How does that relate to me? Man, it's so relevant to us, every single one of us. I mean, I don't see how we can't already understand this, but the path is before us. You see, God has called us all to this. God has called us all to this Christian life. It's a pathway of purpose. And it's not one that we get to call the shots on. It's one that he calls the shots on. It's his purpose and his plan for us. And on that pathway of purpose, we can decide to rebel, to walk away from it. We can decide to kind of walk one foot on, one foot off. We can decide to sometimes be on the path, sometimes not be on the path. And we think God's just going to kind of just look the other way sometimes. That's crazy. What we have to understand is if we want to experience the promises of God, then we have to embrace the purpose of God. And that's really the third point. That third point says one can only claim God's promises after he has embraced his purpose. You can only claim his promise after you've embraced his purpose. See, a lot of times we want to turn to an Old Testament promise, you know? Well, here's what God promises. But the deal is, God promises that to those who are faithful to him. Even think about Romans 8:28, a passage we quote quite often. God is working. God works all things. Or God is actively working all things for the good of those who love him and those who are called according to his purpose. And so it doesn't say God is working all things for the good of those that attend church sometimes, right? I mean, he's saying he's working all things for the good of those who love him and who are called according to his purpose. You could come to church every week and not love God. You could come to church every week and not be called according to his purpose and not be living in the path and the plan that God has for you. And so we've got to understand these are conditional. These promises are conditional on our obedience to God. If we walk in the pathway that he has called us to, then we're going to experience the blessings and the promise of God. And that does not mean, and again, to clarify, there's this terrible untruth in the name of gospel that is spread throughout North America and the world, the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. I regularly try to warn us against it because I would never want anybody to misunderstand the word blessing here, to think that I'm in some way saying that if you're obedient to God, he's going to make you rich. That doesn't happen, right? If you're obedient to God, then you're going to be healthy all the time and never have a sickness. If you have faith enough in God, if you're obedient to God, then everything's going to go right. You're going to have the big house and the right car. Your kids are all going to smile good and not lose their teeth. That just doesn't happen, amen? It just doesn't happen. I mean, the reality of life is that sin comes into the world, it messes everything up, but we are faithful to God. As we're faithful to God, he blesses us. But the blessings that he gives to us may not be defined in terms of wealth and health and prosperity. It would be a different kind of prosperity. God may choose to give you money. He may choose to give you a great house. He may choose a path for you that would be a martyr's path, a path of going as a missionary to a country in the 1040 window where it's a risk for your life to be a believer of Jesus Christ. And so we can never say just because you're obedient to God, you're going to be safe, or just because you're obedient to God, you're going to be rich. That would be absolute error. There's no way. That's not a biblical concept. And so we don't want to even lean that way. But we do understand, and we have to admit, that if we want to be in the blessings of God, we've got to be obedient to God. That's the simple fact. We want to be blessed by God in the sense of, even if that means losing my job, I want to be in the blessings of God. You may say, preacher, how can those things be the same? How can I be blessed by God when I'm losing my job? That makes no sense. You have to go back to Romans 8. You have to trust God. You have to trust God and say, you know what? God is actively working all these things. If I'm obedient to him, if I am walking in his purpose, if I'm walking in his plan, if I'm obedient to him, then I can trust him that he is actively working all of these things for my good, because I know that I love him and I know that I'm called according to his purpose. I'm not leaving this path. I'm going to walk in obedience to him, and I'm going to claim the promises of God that come with the purpose and the plan of God. And so in context, that's how we have to understand it. But man, so many times we forget and we change with the wind and we expect, you know, we may be doing this for so long and then have a change of heart and do the right thing for just a short time and expect God to fix everything. If you started a new diet, you know, at the new year, it may be, you know, if you're like me, sometimes you'd be like, man, I've been on a diet for 3 hours. I have not lost a pound yet. You know, that's terrible, terrible. Or maybe 2 days, you know, you think, it took like 10 months to gain this weight, but I want to lose it in 10 days, man, you know, just some super miraculous. I believe God would get glory in that, amen, I really do. I really hope that he does that, but he, you know, that's the truth of the matter. It takes a long time to gain the weight, and it takes a long time to lose the weight. In the same way, sometimes people make a mistake. I mean, this is relevant, because so many times people come and they think, well, I've made this mistake, or this has happened in my past, and I just, you know, I don't know why I can't get past it. And I'm, you know, well, when did it happen? 3 weeks ago. You know, I mean, it takes time. It takes time to get beyond the consequences of our mistakes. You see, the forgiveness is immediate. God forgives us immediately, but the temporary consequences sometimes take a long time. I mean, those consequences that are in this life, the way that even our testimony has been affected by a decision we made, the way people look at us. The truth of the matter is they may be looking at us that way because we made that mistake. And it will take time to gain their respect back. It will take time to get back where you were. And so by the grace of God, you continue on and you're faithful. And so it's not just some one moment that you make a decision and everything, it changes and everything's perfect. That is not the way it is. Those who obey God operate in the power of God and with His resources, and we have to walk on His path. If we leave the path of His plan, His purpose, it's definitely going to have consequences, and we will not receive the promises of God that we would otherwise. Next thing I want you to see, we just mentioned a moment ago, one can only claim God's promise after he has embraced His purpose. But the problem with that is we are very conditional sometimes in our obedience. We say to God, well, I'll do that if this or if that. I really want us to raise a generation of disciple makers in Simpsonville in the upstate of South Carolina who honestly don't say the word if to God. You know, honestly, if you want to know what the preacher's praying for, I'm praying for some radical born-again children of God who honestly get to the point to where they just willing to, if this was their yes, all right, they just want to put their yes on the table to whatever God's asking, and to stop putting conditions on obedience, but just be obedient. You know, to not say, well, I'll be willing to do that if it works out in my schedule, or if this or that. Even some of this, we'll just use this as an example. Sit with me Sunday, all right? There may be some people who'd say, well, sit with me Sunday. Well, that's a clever little idea. That's cute. All right. Well, I'll pray about that. Let me just tell you. You don't have to pray about this, all right? But see, conditional obedience would say, well, I want to pray about that because I want to see if God wants me to get involved in this. There is no debate. God wants you to get involved in telling people to come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's really not something you need to pray about. You may say, well, preacher, you tell me not to pray. No, don't waste your time praying about something God's already told you to do. See, the problem, yeah, I mean, it's true. I mean, a lot of times, I mean, people even say, well, I just don't know. I need to pray. Does God want me to do this? God want me to do that? Truth of the matter is, we know what God wants. Read His Word. He's told us so many things. So the question is your yes on the table? And not just with this, although that is a very big deal. And it's part of what we're doing for God and His glory. But it's not just that. It's like, okay, you know, God's gifted me to teach. God's gifted me, I'm saying it may be you. God's gifted me to serve in this area. God's given me a spirit of hospitality. God's given me a spirit or a personality that works well with host teams. I could probably be a great greeter. I'll pray about that. Do you really have to pray about it? I mean, I just want you to really think about this. Now, I don't want you to become overwhelmed. If you're doing five things, if you're serving God in 100 areas, you better pray about it, all right? But if you're not doing anything actively ministering and serving in this local church, and God has given you a gift and you know it's a gift, He has wired you a particular way, and there's a no-doubt situation to where you know you fit somewhere. It's just a question of if you want to, if you're willing to. I would say you need to stop praying about what you know God's already told you to do. Put your yes on the table and listen for the question, because I promise you, He is asking it now. He is asking it now. He's saying, Wayne, will you do this? Will you say yes to this? Wayne, are you willing? Are you willing to tell the truth? Are you willing to challenge my people? Are you willing to serve? Are you willing to hold a door? Are you willing to teach a child? Are you willing to do children's church? Are you willing to do this stuff? I mean, is your yes on the table to whatever God's asking you? Or is it conditional obedience? Is it one of those things where, you know, if it works out, if I'm in town, you know, we travel so much. You know, we're gone at least, you know, 2 out of 4 weeks. And so I just don't... Conditional obedience. Let me just challenge you, man. Say yes to God. Walk in His pathway, walk in His purpose, walk in His plan. I promise you, He will bless you for it. He will bless you for it. There's no possible way you will miss that which you think you are going to give up by saying yes to him. Here's what happens. We want the temple, but we don't want to do the work. That's, I think, what was happening here. If you had polled the children of Israel in Haggai's day, during that 15 years when they did nothing and said, hey, guys, let's take a vote. How many of you people wish we had the temple for God? I mean, they would have all probably unanimously said, I think the temple's a great idea. I just don't want to be the one that worked. Do you know the Samaritans got mad at us last time? I don't want to rock the boat, so now's not the time. But we do want the temple. We want the temple. We're just not willing to do what it takes to have the temple. And it reminds me a lot of Numbers 13 and 14. If you remember the children of Israel, you remember when they sent the 12 spies out into the land, and 10 of the spies came back, naysayers. 2 of them came back and said, hey man, Joshua and Caleb said, we can take this land. God has given us a promise. There's a pathway to the promise, and we're going to claim the promise of God. But the 10 spies said, no, there's no way. We're like grasshoppers in their sight. And so what happened? God punished an entire generation because the people would not obey, would not walk the pathway of purpose to achieve the promise. And again, you may say, we're talking about children of Israel in the Old Testament. This is so in your lap today. It's in my face, all right? If I want the promise of God, I can say all day long, I want God's best for my kids. I want God's best for my family. I want to be the man of God God's called me to be. I want to be the wife that God's called me to be. I want to be the child. I want to be the son or the daughter God's called me to be. Here's the pathway that leads to the promise of God for me in that. It's just literally about saying yes to the pathway of purpose that God is leading you on. It's that. It's obeying God. You may say, preacher, that's just oversimplification. No, it's not. It is that simple. Do we want to really be Jesus followers or not? Are we playing a temple game? Not temple run. I'm sorry, ADD kicked in again. Not the temple gun, run game. But you know, are we playing some game with God? Or are we going through the motions? Are we serious about this? Is this really, are we Jesus followers? Do we want Jesus to really invade our space and to get in our business and to be in control of our lives? That's what it means to walk in the purpose of God that leads to the promise of God. And we shouldn't get on the other end of things and start saying, God, where's my promise? Where's my promise? Because he's going to say, man, where were you on the pathway of purpose? You didn't follow me. You didn't follow me when I was leading. And here's another, man, this is so misunderstood, I think, in our day. Holiness is so misunderstood. Depending on what denominational background, liturgical type background you come from, you can have a really misunderstanding of this, a bad misunderstanding of this. But holiness is about surrender. Holiness requires surrender. I've heard people through the years even be so confused as to say something like, and they may get it from like Old Testament passages in the temple, or something about that, but talk about like candles somehow make a place holy. That, you know, if they're candle, now, let me say this. Christmas Eve candlelight service, isn't that beautiful? That's a special service, you know? When everything's lit, we always see it as beautiful. Man, just the environment is an amazing environment. And would you even say it's a holy environment? Yeah, I would use that terminology. That's a beautiful, holy environment. In that service. But does the candlelight make it holy? No. God, you know, the presence of God is ultimately what brings the glory on any environment. It's not some kind of furniture that's on the stage. It's not some apparel that hangs in our closet. And again, from a New Testament context, this is why it's so important when we're talking about this. We're talking about being obedient to God. It's because in the Old Testament, obviously, God lived in the temple, right? God lived in the Holy of Holies in this temple. But now in the New Testament, when Jesus died on the cross, the curtain that separated this place called the Holy of Holies where God dwelt, the curtain was torn. Jesus, when he died on the cross, God ripped the temple curtain in half, signifying basically now we can enter into the presence of God. Where before we couldn't, you know, before in the Old Testament context, God lived in the temple, but we couldn't really go into his presence. It was impossible. In the New Testament, we've become the temple. This is awesome. Look, This is not the temple of God. Let me go this far. This building is not the church. Well, preacher's on the sign. I don't know if you saw that, but it says church on the sign out there. This building is not the church. You are. You are the church. You are the church. You are the temple of God. You are where God dwells. Your heart. And so where we get all messed up, it's just like the people here in Haggai, we're getting all messed up, is when we start thinking somehow in external terms over internal terms. And we start thinking, okay, in some sense, it's all about the outside, and we got to make, and that's like a Pharisaical approach too, because Pharisees, you know, Jesus even accused them of being whitewashed tombs filled with dead men's bones, and he told them it doesn't matter how pretty it is on the outside, what matters is what's on the inside. And here in Haggai, look at 12, 13, and 14. Haggai 2, 12 says, if someone carries consecrated meat in the fold of the garment, and that fold touches some bread or stew, some wine, olive oil, or other food, does it become consecrated? Well, the priest said, no. And then look at verse 13. Then Haggai said, well, if a person defiled by contact with a dead body touches one of these things, does it become defiled? He said, yes. The priest replied, it becomes defiled. Look at verse 14. Then Haggai said, so it is with this people and this nation in my sight, declares the Lord. Whatever they do and whatever they offer, their offer is defiled. Here's what he was trying to say. He's basically saying, look, if washed hands touch a dirty plate, this is another question here, okay? If washed hands touch a dirty plate, do the clean hands make the plate clean? And the answer to that is no. If that were the case, I would wash the dishes every day. Amen? Because you could just walk in the kitchen, touch the dishes, and it would be awesome. My clean hands touch dirty dishes, they immediately become clean. But the problem with that is if I have clean hands and I touch dirty dishes, my hands get dirty. That's what happens. And so in the same way, we can know, it's kind of like spaghetti sauce. Spaghetti sauce gets on everything, right? It's just, I mean, you can't get it off. I mean, you can think nothing's on your mouth. You ever do this? Am I the only one? You wipe your mouth when you're eating spaghetti, and it's like, that's crazy. How did that much sauce get on my lips? That's ridiculous. Have you ever done that? Is it just me? Spaghetti sauce is weird like that. But here's what we say. Sin is like that. You see, sin, we think somehow that if we have a corrupt heart, middle school, high school, college, middle age, senior adult, we think somehow if we've got this corrupt heart, this bad attitude, this judgmental spirit, this lustful longing, whatever it is, man, whatever it is, we think somehow if we got this sin in our heart, that if we put some kind of outward show on and say some words and wear some clothes, that somehow it's okay. And that is foolishness. That's foolishness. To think that somehow the outside is more important than the inside. Because if your heart isn't right, then nothing else you do will be right either, right? If your heart's not right, you forget it, man. You're not holy. You're not righteous. You can fool everybody. You can try to walk through life, going through the motions and acting like you're living right. But the truth of the matter is, holiness comes when we give our heart to Jesus completely. When we surrender. Holiness requires surrender. When your heart isn't right with God, whatever you do will be wrong. When your heart isn't right with God, whatever you do will be wrong. Here's the final thing, just kind of a different way of stating it. God wanted in this text, in Haggai, God wanted more than a nice temple. And so he's trying to shake them. He's saying, look, guys, I know y'all are thinking we're just going to build a temple. I want more than a nice temple. He wanted the hearts of those men and women to be fully devoted to him. And in the same way, God doesn't just want us to go through the motions. He doesn't want us to just look the part. He doesn't just want us to attend church. I definitely think you should faithfully attend worship. You should be hungry and passionate about what God has to say. Now, we should come in here with the excitement of the national championship. I'm telling you. I believe that. Some people joke around about that kind of stuff. I believe it. I really do. I believe if you're not as fired up about Jesus as you are Alabama or Clemson, then honestly, I don't know. That's crazy, man. I mean, Jesus literally hung on a cross for your sins. What did Nick Saban do for me, you know? I would have said Dabo, but some of y'all would know that's Jesus' brother, man. Watch out. You're talking about Dabo. Hey, Dabo will be striking you down, brother. He's like the fourth person of the Trinity. What you talking about? Everybody say, God loves Dabo. Everybody say that. God loves Dabo. All right, yeah. I really do. He's a godly man. Praise God for Dabo. But Dabo didn't die on the cross for you. And we got to have a passion about Jesus. You see, that really has to change us. He wants our heart. He wants us to be as passionate about Him as we are about anything, about anyone. I should love Him more than I love Amy. I hope you're listening to this, man. I should care more about what my Savior thinks about me than about what my children think about me. I should be motivated by pleasing Him more than I'm motivated by a paycheck that will burn. You see, God wants your heart. God wants your heart. He doesn't just want a pretty temple. He wants our hearts completely given to Him. Well, here's what happened in the text. These people's have to turn to a want to. They stopped having to do it. They started wanting to do it. And I just have to ask, what would happen if we stopped having to go to church and we started wanting to worship God? What if we stopped having to tithe and we started wanting to give God our resources? What would happen if we stopped having to serve Him and we started wanting to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ? I am telling you, this is absolute no overstatement. It would shake the upstate of South Carolina if this church, honestly, if we would surrender. I'm talking about completely turn our hearts over to God. There is no end, there's no measure to what God would do through us if we would just say yes. Is your yes on the table? Well, preacher, what's the question? Doesn't matter. Whatever God's asking, is your answer yes? Lord, we love You, and I pray, God, during this time, that You would challenge us. I pray that we would be uncomfortable. God, shake us up. Help us not be satisfied with what we are, who we are, where we are. Lord, I pray that You would drive us toward that pathway of purpose this morning. It may be that some people are just off track a little bit. Maybe we've just one step or two. And there may be some who, they need the light shined on the path so they can find it again right now, God. I pray that You would just speak to us, that You would bring us to our knees. Some, maybe physically, God, but others, I pray in their hearts right now that we'd just give You our heart. You're chasing us, God. I pray that we would surrender to You. That we would give You everything, even this hour, in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand?